Our salvation. pleased by sacrifices of that kind.
Hear your gospel, wisdom intended.
Truth.
young lad, about 8 or 9, I did something very foolish. I'm sure nobody here has done anything foolish, but I did something very foolish. I stood in front of, I was in the basement of my home, my family home, standing in front of the washing machine, but with my back to the clothes washer, right? And I reached back, and I grasped the clothes washer with the palms and fingers of my hand, trying to hold tightly. I leaned forward. I want to see how far forward I can go. And in an instant, my face hit the concrete basement floor, and my right front tooth pierced and gashed my lip. There was a lot of blood. My parents said I needed to go to the ER. I pleaded not to go. My grandfather took my side. He said the wound would heal on its own. But Mom and Dad prevailed. And off we went to Election Brothers Hospital. And I can still taste the antiseptic on my lip and feel the needle threading the sutures to close up my wound. Now, the ER doctors, the doctor and nurses knew what to do. They knew to clean the wound, assess it, suture it, and give me a tetanus shot. A week or two later, the sutures were removed, and that pinched. Now, suppose the ER doctor and nurse said that they would close the wound by packing dirt into it and that they would seal it with the latest super glue that would permanently bond the dirt to my lip. I think my parents would have grabbed me and taken me to another hospital. But what if my grandfather had prevailed and my parents allowed the wound to heal on its own? I could have gotten a bad infection. And surely a larger area would have to heal. And I'd be left with a larger, more prominent scar on my lip. And you really can't see it. You'd probably have to come closer to me than you'd want to see it. Now, in the decades since that accident, I don't think much has changed since I cut my lip. In terms of doctors and nurses understanding how a wound heals at the cellular level, how an unclean wound can become infected, or why and how it needs to be sutured. Some of the particulars may have changed. I'm sure there have been new developments in wound care, as well as in materials used to suture wounds. Doctors and nurses have all learned this, have learned all of this in accredited medical and nursing schools, and they learned their basic sciences at accredited colleges and universities. So in theory, at least, my parents could have taken me to any emergency room, and my wound would have been treated in the same way. Well, how does this relate to today's readings and the Sunday of the Sixth Ecumenical Councils, which we observe today? We know that the church is made up of many dioceses or eparchies, archdioceses and archeparchies, each with their own local parishes and with seminaries, universities, colleges, high schools, primary schools, hospitals. It's a worldwide system, to borrow term used by Pope Francis, a worldwide system of field hospitals. And I would also add wellness centers for body, mind, and soul. The constant through all time and place is Jesus Christ, who entered human history some 2,000 years ago. As we heard in Hebrews 13 tonight, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. those who teach should not be teaching about super glue and dirt. Right? Now, the six ecumenical councils were crucial in helping the church to understand and to teach what God revealed us, what the triune God revealed to us through sacred scripture and holy tradition, and to reject strange teachings that arose during the early centuries of Christianity. The councils were specifically convened to reject false opinions and heresies. Now let's consider very briefly the first three councils. The first council was convened in 325, and it rejected false ideas about that the members of the Trinity differed from one another in their level of divinity. So that council established the true understanding of our triune God. And 50 years later, the second council needed to be convened to reaffirm the divinity of the Holy Spirit. Because there was a heresy building momentum that denied the Holy Spirit's divinity. The third council rejected the claim that Jesus was two distinct persons, one human and one divine, and established that Jesus is one person of two natures, human and divine. It also, the third council also proclaimed Mary, ever-virgin, the Theotokos, the God-bearer. Now, false teachings can die slowly, and new ones can threaten the church. Some more councils were called to deal with. If you go home and spend time with just reading through, praying, the Nicene Creed, or the hymn to the only begotten Son, which we have already chanted into the liturgy today, there are nice summaries of the teachings of these six councils. Now let's fast forward to 1962. What happened then? In terms of the church, that's when St. Pope John the 23rd convened the Second Vatican Council. And that council ended 3 years later under the leadership of his successor, Pope St. Paul VI. And this council was different from the first councils that we observe today. There were no doctrinal issues to settle, no heresies to reject. The council's goal was to bring the light of Christ to the modern world. And here we are, some 55, 56 years later, and the church and all of its members, and that includes you and me, we're trying to fully comprehend and understand the meaning of the Second Vatican Council and how to bring it to its fullness. So what to do? First, we'll get Pope St. John the 23rd's words as he opened the council. He said the traditional as well as the contemporary approach to life is to strive with all zeal for evangelical perfection and to contribute to the material good of humanity. In other words, we must learn to imitate, how to best imitate Christ in the face of the headwinds of our time. And make that faith more widely known throughout the world, more deeply understood, and have it inform, help us to make moral decisions. And the moral decisions of the day are extremely complex. And finally, John the 23rd spoke of the need for the unity in the truth. And that unity about which he spoke is that same unity that Jesus prayed for to his Father, as we heard in today's gospel reading from John. Holy Father, keep them in your name that you have given me so that they may be one just as we are, we, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, so that they may share my joy completely. And Jesus continued to pray, consecrate them in your truth. Your word is truth. He said, I consecrate myself for them so that they may also be consecrated to truth. I pray not only for them, but also for those who believe in me through their word. You know who that is? That's you and me. Those who have taken, embraced the teachings of Christ and his first apostles. And he prays for us so that they may all be one, that we may all be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they may also be in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. No better way to bring somebody to Christ than to be reflections of his unity. To be in communion with him, to be in communion with one another. And he said, he prays, I in them and you in me, that they may be brought to perfection as one. Brothers and sisters, Jesus is praying for our sanctification. He wants us to grow in union with him and with one another. Now, this is certainly not how the world looks today. There's polarization in the church, in our world, in our country. Some of it as glaring and fresh as the gash on my lip many years ago. And this polarization, this separation, is not of God. It's diabolical. It's of the evil. The diabolical comes from the Greek, and it means to tear apart, to scatter. And scattered we are. Almost over 30,000 Christian denominations worldwide. Politically, every day you can hear talking heads vilifying anybody with a different view, the same with racial and ethnic groups. And this is Satan's goal. In C.S. Lewis's Screwtape Letters, the devil is Screwtape and he's writing letters to his nephew, Wormwood. There's a devil in training. And what he writes is, hatred is best combined with fear. The more he,
the man, Wormwood is supposed to turn away from God,
the more he fears, the more he will hate. And to make a deep wound in his charity, you should therefore defeat his courage. When the evil one tries to manipulate us, often through puppets in the media, fear can fill our hearts, leading us to hate and being uncharitable with our brothers and sisters. Remember, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. He is our guiding light. The church, filled with the Holy Spirit, provides what we need on our journey to the Father. That's the same Christ who said, do not be afraid. Live today's message from the Hebrews. Do not neglect to do good and to share what you have. God is pleased by sacrifices of that kind. The writer of Hebrews also explained that we need to let mutual love continue. Do not neglect hospitality. Be mindful of prisoners as of sharing their and of the ill-treated, as of yourselves. Let marriage be honored among all. Let your life be free from love of money
served in this holy church, our spiritual father, and for all our brothers and sisters in Christ.
Lord, have mercy.
Thank you. revealed himself to us.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, from the heavens. Praise him in the highest, praise him in the highest. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
And Job. Say with all your people, bless your new king.
We have seen the true light. We have received the heavenly spirit. We have found the true faith, and we worship the undivided Trinity, for the Trinity has
filled with your grace, O Lord, so that we
Thank you, Father.
So we have some exciting things going on this week and a lot of reasons for you to pray. You want multiple reasons to pray?
Yes.
Number one, God asks us to pray. Praying is talking to God. Why would we not want to talk to God? Why would we not want to be here in church and be with God? So that's number one. We also want your prayers for a young couple in our parish who will be united in Christ and now have the third partner living with them starting on Friday. Who is the third partner in every marriage? And don't say an in-law. God, Jesus is the third partner, the invisible third partner in every marriage. And so we lift up in our prayers very joyfully Paul Rizzo and Stephanie Hoffman, who will be united in Christ here in church on Friday, July 23rd at 3 o'clock. So please do keep them in your prayers, okay? Also, we have a holy day this week. Anybody, I'll tell you, it's going to be on Tuesday. Now, the council, you may not answer, deacons, you may not answer. Anybody else can tell me which holy day it is? St. Elias. Okay, very good. And St. Elias, what do we bless? On the feast of St. Elias, we do not save ourselves. We always bless ourselves.
Cars.
All right. Why do we bless our cars?
Because
it's a tradition. Yes, I know that. Why do we bless our car?
He had a chariot.
He had because he drove a chariot. Yes, and what happened to the chariot? Where did it go?
To heaven.
To heaven, that's exactly right. And tradition tells us that St. Elias is still circling the world, the cosmos, in his chariot, and will return just prior to the second coming of our Lord. So we celebrate the feast of St. Elias and the blessing of our own chariots, our cars, or bless your Miroslav, we bless his shoes because he walks everywhere. We will bless our vehicles on Tuesday following the Divine Liturgy, and also 1 week from today on the weekend of Saturday and Sunday. So that's a reminder for all of us. So a lot of good praying this week. As Deacon reminded at the beginning of the liturgy, our floors in the hall are being cleaned, so the hall is off limits for right now. It's receiving probably three, possibly four coats of wax. It's right now curing between the second and the third coat, so all is off limits now. I know you're just dying to go in there and look at it and walk on the floor, but wait until next week, okay? So that's it for the announcements. God willing, we will see you safe and sound next weekend with your cars to be blessed, or pray God on Tuesday for the actual day of the holy day itself, okay? The blessing of the Lord be of God, whose grace and loving kindness always, now and ever and forever. Prayers of Hyacinth and Gideon, dedicated to the prayers of all the saints, the Christ.